thanks everyone for coming. What John Prescott didn't tell you is that he's a veteran with an Army doc for a number of years, so he speaks about this with great authority. I'm another one of those docs who trained in VAs here in DC and in California. It's an amazing patient population. It's an amazingly valuable training experience and educational experience, and one we really value. John talked about those partnerships, as Dr. Clancy. I wanted to bring this back to the larger environment that physician shortage in the U.S. is going to hit the most vulnerable populations first. Whether you're talking about veterans or people who are poor living in their cities or those living in rural areas or those who are disabled or they're chronically ill elderly, those are the people that are going to get hit far often much before you and I in this room in most cases. And that to address that shortage and to address the shortage not just for the VA but for the nation, we can do a couple of things. And again, this is a foreshadowing of what's to come. And a number of quotes up here most recently, the acting secretary yesterday said during his testimony that the VA believes they have to hire an additional 1,500 physicians and 8,500 other healthcare providers, social workers, nurses, psychologists, therapists, etc. That's going to be very difficult in the current context. The VA shortage becomes worsened because they've got constraints, financial constraints, they've got constraints in terms of their ability to act quickly in some cases. But there's also issues around the challenges of that patient population. They are a challenging population, incredibly rewarding, but particularly as our men and women come back from the most recent wars, they've got a number of problems from mental health issues to disability issues that make it more challenging to solve. And so there's a lot more of a buyer's market for doctors that want to go out and employ in another healthcare system. We think that exposure to the VA and training education actually does help in recruiting folks into that system. We also know that around us and around the VA and the nation, this problem is going to get worse. And as Dr. Clancy mentioned, it's the aging population more than anything else. They use more services per capita than the younger population. We also have our aging baby boomer physicians that are retiring. I was just reading the state of Washington expects that 20% of their physicians are going to retire in the next 5 years based upon their surveys from 2012. Population's growing overall. The medical advances that allow us to turn fatal illnesses into chronic illnesses mean that you and I and our parents and our siblings and our kids are going to be consuming care much, much longer in the future with chronic diseases. And if we don't train some more physicians, we're actually going to decrease the number of physicians we per capita we have in this country at a time when per capita needs are rising. This is from this week's CBO report. And if you look at it, it's not just the growth in 65 and over, it's the growth of 75 and over, 85 and over. And you're doubling that older population in the course of a couple of decades. And that matters. So this is utilization of physician services by age range. And you can see that when you get to 65 and 75, your utilization of primary care doubles or triples, but your utilization of medical specialists, surgical subspecialists, and others like emergency room physicians, pathology, anesthesia, radiology, all of that increases as well. And so when you match up this chart and that chart, you got a problem. So what do we do about it? Well, we expect that the numbers aren't exact, but somewhere around a shortage of 130,000 physicians for the next dozen years. Half of them in primary care, particularly adult primary care, and pediatrics, it's more among the subspecialties that there's a greater need. And the other half are really spread among lots of other specialists. To put this in context, we train about 7,000 primary care physicians a year. I'm a general internist, so I'm one of those that stayed in primary care. We train about 500 oncologists a year, less than 400 dermatologists a year. So part of this is figuring out how to boost each of those areas appropriately. And again, just some more context, there are less than 20,000 physicians in the entire VA health system. So you're talking about six times the size of the VA health system for the number of doctors we're gonna need. And again, as we look at the likely projections, this is spread out pretty equally between primary care and many, many other specialties. This is a snapshot of just going on the VA central site, the website last week, about a week ago, looking at, I'm sorry, my percentage didn't show up, but 5% administrative, 19% in primary care, and really over 70% in other specialties. Which ones? Vascular surgery, orthopedic surgery, dermatology, gastroenterology, cardiology, lots of other specialties. And we think this is somewhat representative of what that older population is going to look like, with multiple healthcare needs, multiple specialties, and the need for a strong medical home. So what are we doing about it? We're standing here telling you the problem. What have we done to try and address it? Well, for the first time in 25 years, this is the number of medical school entrants since 1980. Back in 2006, we recommended that our med schools expand through existing and new schools to actually boost the front of the pipeline. So we've done that, and we're on track to expand 30% in the next 2 or 3 years. The challenge is, no one can go out and practice medicine at the medical school. They have to do residency training in the VA, in the teaching hospital, community health centers, in lots of different areas. And the challenge we're faced with now is, if you look on the top left, we had 26,500 students go into US MD and DO programs this year. We only had 26,678 positions available in the ACGME accredited match. Those numbers are far too close. And the concern here is we've already had nearly 2,000 graduates of US medical schools that didn't match this year. By the time all and said was done, we found a spot for 400 out of 975. It's unclear what happened to the other 860 prior year grads. We don't have all that data available, but it's a real concern. GME is the bottleneck. We can educate more medical students. We can graduate them with MDs and DOs, but if we can't train them, they can't get out and serve the community, whether that's the VA or in other settings. Why is this? Well, one reason is that back with the Balanced Budget Act of 1997, for deficit reduction reasons, Congress capped Medicare's share of its support at 1996 levels. That's been a real problem in our ability to grow the number of training programs, notwithstanding the VA's investment in that additional 1,500 positions. So what we've ended up with is physicians that have either graduated domestically or gone to medical school abroad, in that green line on top, applying for the red line number of positions. It's a waste of human resources for us not to have training opportunities for these positions. So in order to do this, we need to address both a continued investment from the VA side in GME positions, because we think exposure in that setting is good for us as physicians in our learning, and also makes us better prepared and more inclined to treat veterans as we go forward in our careers. And we need to lift that Medicare GME cap. And this is only part of the solution. We're not talking about training another 130,000 doctors. We're talking about doing this, figuring out how to use the other members of the healthcare team, how to do some of the things in telemedicine that the VA is leading on, try to figure out how we reduce unnecessary services where that's possible, while making sure people get some of the services that they haven't been getting that they really need. And as the people looking at legislation to address the VA crisis begin to look for options, I would encourage you to look at any one of these three bills that we have pending in the House and Senate. You can't address the VA doctor shortage without addressing the U.S. doctor shortage. And again, those bills are out there for you to draw from. In the short term, as Dr. Prescott mentioned, we need to do some work on figuring out how we do expedited contracting with non-VA providers. Certainly, we believe that our medical schools, our faculty, our teaching hospitals, because of their affiliation agreements and existing relationships, ought to be a place where we can accelerate that happening, making sure that we have timely payment for that. But as John pointed out, we have medical schools and teaching hospitals there at the ready, waiting to help. And so we're really glad that Dr. Clancy can join us today, that the VA is willing to partner with us. With that, I'll turn it over to Pat Burnett. I'll show you these again. These are my colleagues' contact information. I'll open that up again at the end. Thanks, Pat.